Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being promptly in your spaces, ready for our next event. And I hope you had a great opportunity during the break to visit some of the great exhibits. We'll have plenty more time to do that after the next couple of events for us here at the Land Forces Pacific Conference 2018. It's my great privilege now to introduce to the panel the Commanding General of the United States Army Training and Doctrine Command, General Steve Townsend. Obviously, General Townsend is not here with us in person, but he's here with us in spirit, to be sure. And I think, General Townsend, it's safe to say that you would rather be here than where you are. Nonetheless, we are very, very pleased that you were able to carve out a little bit of time to spend with the great assemblage here. We had a great kickoff this morning by General Brown in our great first panel that gave us some very provocative ideas to think about. And we certainly now welcome, please join me in welcoming General Steve Townsend, United States Army Training and Doctrine Command.
Thanks. Thanks, General Hamm. How do y'all hear me? Somebody give me a thumbs up if you're good. Okay, all right, good, great, thank you. So I'm calling you from my headquarters at Fort Eustis, Virginia, and General Hamm's absolutely right. I would rather be there with all of you. I canceled this because of a series of pop-up meetings with our Army headquarters. And over the last 2 days, I have been in about 10 continuous hours of line-by-line budget review meetings, and we didn't get done today, so we're going to frag the schedule for tomorrow and have another round of budget review meetings. So it is clear to me I'd much rather be in Hawaii with all of you at LANPAC. I'd like to thank USARPAC and the Association of the United States Army for their leadership in pulling this together, in particular General Hamm and General Brown for organizing this event that I had planned to attend. I'm going to talk to you about two things today briefly. First, and I'll take some questions at the end, and if I were there, I would go ahead and nominate a question asker. So just to kind of get through that little spot where I say I'm ready for questions and no one asks one for a while. So I'm going to count on someone to very quickly ask the first question and get the room moving on questions. I'm going to talk to you about two things today. First, I'm going to officially announce a shift in how we talk about multi-domain battle in our Army. We've actually made a shift a few weeks ago. I haven't really said it publicly. I'm going to say it publicly to you today. And then I'm going to kind of preview a panel that you're going to have tomorrow that will review multi-domain operations in mega cities. And I'll talk about that a little bit and give some insights from my experience during the recent battles of Mosul and Raqqa, which I participated in. So first, evolving the name. So multi-domain battle is now multi-domain operations. How did that come about? Well, specifically when I took command here, both the new Secretary of the Army and the Chief of Staff of the Army grabbed by the stacking swivel and said, I want you to operationalize multi-domain battle throughout our Army. So I wasn't really sure then what that means. I'm gaining an increasing understanding of what operationalizing multi-domain battle means. So there's been a lot of great work done by the folks here at TRADOC, other stakeholders, to include those there in the Pacific, AOR, Admiral Harris at PACOM, and General Brown there, USARPAC, have been champions of multi-domain operations. And employment of standing up and employing our first multi-domain task force experimental formation out there. And many of our multinational partners have also been doing great work alongside of us. Japan, Australia, Korea, the UK, just to name a few, and others. So what's in the name change? Well, so let's just look at the name, the word battle. Battles, when you say the word battle, people think of people dying, destruction being wrought. It's ruthless, it's barbaric. Battles are often a necessary part of war. Battles win fights, battles take ground. Battles in and of themselves do not win war. the word battle also doesn't really apply to the part of conflict that happens before actual armed conflict, the competition phase, both prior to conflict and after conflict. States are in a state of competition. So the world we live in today is not really defined so much by battles, but as by persistent competition that cycles sometimes into conflict and then back out, and sometimes you avoid, you deter conflict, and you stay in a state of competition. This is actually highlighted in our national defense strategy. And I don't know if there are slides up. Are there any slides up? If somebody give me a thumbs up or something. Should be a slide up with like a little wheel on it. Okay, great, thank you. So that slide there, multi-domain operations, the competition cycle. So our national defense strategy, the U.S. National defense strategy, talks about this cycle of competition. You get into a period of heightened tensions, and you either deter conflict or you don't. If you deter conflict, you go back into competition. You stay in competition. If you don't deter conflict, you enter armed conflict. You emerge from armed conflict back into competition. This is sort of our approach with the U.S. National Defense Strategy. And our adversaries, who remain nameless, but you can imagine who they might be here, are really good at this competition phase. And they're improving their game at competition. So this is as if the United States shows up for the World Cup, and we show up at the stadium in the right country, in the right stadium, and we're equipped and organized to win of course, the reality is, you know, the United States is probably not going to win at the World Cup. But despite that, our adversaries actually show up in a different country, at a different stadium. They play a different game, and while we're waiting for the World Cup to start, our adversaries actually announce to the world that they've won the championship match and claim their title. This is where, in competition, we're not playing on the same pitch. So I think we have to do a better job in competition, knowing where the game's being played, what the game is, and we've got to bring our game. So as our adversaries expand, this is a lift from our national defense strategy, U.S. national defense strategy. Our adversaries are expanding coercion, violating principles of sovereignty, exploiting ambiguity, deliberately blurring the lines between civilian and military goals, thus undermining the international order from within the system by exploiting its benefits while undercutting its principles and the rules of the road. So winning battles does not necessarily equate to winning in competition and vice versa. We think we've got to be more focused on winning in competition prior to armed conflict. And this is probably not that different than how much of the world operated, the Western world operated during the Cold War. We had a 40-plus year competition that largely, by the primary competitors, refrained from armed conflict. There were armed conflict on the fringes of the Cold War and by proxies and partners, but the main competitors in the Cold War managed to avoid armed conflict by and large. And I think we've got to get back that competition game. So we've gone to we've replaced the word battle with operations. And we think it's more inclusive. We think it's a better bridge between the tactical and strategic. Several observers pointed out to us that during my first month of command here, that the word battle was sort of limiting and stifling some conversation growth of the concept for several reasons. One, the word battle sounds more tactical than strategic. We needed buy-in from our sister services. They preferred the word operations. Our interagency inside the U.S. government and our partner nations preferred the word operations. I had a State Department, an ambassador from the State Department tell me, we don't do battle, we do operations. And then I think also the word operations recognizes that cycle better. battle kind of zooms in on the conflict, that's only one-third of the cycle on the slide in front of you. The word operations describes what happens around the entire cycle, the competition phase. So I think multi-domain battle served its purpose. It's created a foundation for us to think and talk about multi-domain operations, and it's gotten the concept up and running and moving forward. I think operations will, that title will be on our next revision to our concept. We're calling what we've got on the street today multi-domain battle one is version 1.0. Our goal is to release by this fall multi-domain operations 1.5. That'll be an evolution of our concept. Largely will be U.S. Army document, but we want it to be joint service and multinational partner capable, that document. So we're going to make sure that there's a place in there and that we don't go down a path that will prevent our multinational partners and our joint services from signing on to that concept. We think they will. We've got great collaboration within the U.S. Department of Defense, and we think that this will be eventually a joint U.S. Concept. Okay, I'm going to stop talking about multi-domain operations at this point, and I can talk more about it in questions and answers if you'd like. I'm going to shift gears now, and I'm going to talk about multi-domain operations in a particular environment, that of megacities. And I'm hoping that you're looking at a slide called Multi-Domain Operations and Megacities. I'll talk off this slide. Thank you for the thumbs up. I acknowledge. So wars basically are fought and won or lost where the people are, where the population is. By the UN estimates, by 2030, two-thirds of the world's population will live in large urban areas. The UN also estimates that this phenomenon known as megacities will increase from 30 today, roughly, to 60. By in that same time frame. And large cities, which is the next category down, will go from 45 to 88. So what's a megacity? What's a large city? A large city has a population of 5 to 10 million. A megacity is hyperpopulated, 10 million or more. It's complex in all dimensions, extraordinarily large, physically nearly unboundable. So think of a city that you could physically surround or isolate. Nearly impossible to do that with a megacity. So large city like Mosul, we were able to actually physically surround Mosul. It took us several months to get it done, but we were able to do it eventually. So in 2016, in the Asia-Pacific region, 16 of the 31 megacities exist in that region. And six out of the 10 largest megacities are in your region of the world. And again, that's scheduled to double probably in the next 15 years or so. So clearly, war in urban settings is going to happen. Like your nations, our military doctrine used to tell commanders to avoid cities altogether, bypass cities if you can do it. What this is telling us is it will be impossible to do. I think it's been impossible for a number of years. The enemy will dig into cities and force you to root him out. But clearly it will be impossible to avoid combat in large cities, in mega cities in the future. So how will we do multi-domain operations in mega cities? There's an old analogy, a little kind of a description of war in large cities by a former U.S. Marine general named Kulak. Many of you are familiar with him and his three-block war. What that means is that the battle would be so complex and on such complex terrain that in one part of the city you might be handing out humanitarian assistance, in another part you might be doing counterinsurgency or wide area security, and in another part you might be fighting high-intensity conflict. And so I think multi-domain operations is going to have room in it for us to do that in megacities. There's three points I'll make about fighting in megacities: reverberation, power, and flow. So let me talk about that. What does reverberation mean? Basically, it's an echo. every act you do in a city reverberates. So where out in the rural area or in a small village, you can probably contain or isolate the effects of your operations, the things that you say, the things that you do, the destruction that you create, the casualties you inflict are probably isolated to that part of the battlefield. In any large city, these things reverberate out like ripples in a pond, and they hit the edge of the pond, the edge of the pool, and they even come back in. Another good analogy of this is Dr. Russ Glenn at a recent megacity conference that I attended in New York City. He's from our TRADOC G2. He described a rack of billiard balls. So you strike the cue ball and it smashes into the rack of billiard balls and they go pinging all over the table. And even the best pool players can only predict where one or two of those balls are actually going to go. The rest of the rack does what the rest of the rack is going to do. And I think that's a lot like the thought about reverberation. Every act you take, every decision, every word is going to reverberate out through a city and have effects. Some of them you can predict, many of them you can't. Flow and power. So let me talk about that. So flow and power. Every city, large or small, has a flow. The rhythm, the direction of daily life. You can see flow happen at rush hour in every city. Life flows into a city at rush hour. It flows back out of the city in evening rush hour. That's a good basic and macro example of the flow of a city. Crisis in a city and conflict in a city interrupts that normal flow and creates a new flow. And probably the best practitioners of urban warfare will figure out how to disrupt the flow of a city to the least degree possible and use the flow of the city to your advantage. My own army has learned these lessons the hard way overseas in the last 17 years, where sometimes we didn't recognize that there was a flow to life in a city, and that we created our own flows sometimes to our detriment, ignored the existing flow, didn't try to use it to our advantage, and created our own flows. Sometimes those worked, sometimes they didn't. Power also flows through a city, not just electrical power, which is sort of obvious, but also political power, economic power, cultural power, informational power, security power flows through a city. And the local folks know the flow of power. The partner forces probably know the flow. First responders know the flow. And I think if we're going to undertake operations in a large city or mega city, you better invest some time in understanding the flow of a city's life and the flow of power and all the types of power that flow through a city. Again, you can impose your own flow. You can impose your own power on a city. You're going against the grain frequently when you do that, could be to your detriment. And so I think we've got to be informed about that. I know that I'm much more conscious of this. And even with that experience of the last nearly two decades of war, I watched and learned from our Iraqi partners as we operated in Iraq. This is where I got these ideas about flow and power in cities, was watching the Iraqis take back Mosul from ISIS. And they had ideas that I appreciated only after having watched them unfold. Now, just because they were the local security forces, that mean they had all the answers. They didn't get it right every time either. But we need to all do the best we can because it'll help our operations. Okay, I'm going to shift. Let's change slides to a slide called Intensity of Urban Warfare. I'm going to talk about Mosul, the Battle of Mosul, just a little bit. Mosul doesn't really qualify as a megacity for sure, and it's not even by definition a large city. I would tell you that it's the largest city I've ever participated in operations against in high-intensity combat. I did have participated in operations in Kabul. I participated in operations in Kandahar. I participated in operations in Baghdad. Baghdad probably being the largest city where I participated in combat operations. But those, again, were counterinsurgency and wide-area security operations. Mosul's the largest place where I've closely observed, large-scale combat operations at the high, mid to high intensity end of the spectrum of conflict. So a little bit of a historical comparison here. Mosul's not really Stalingrad in a lot of ways. It doesn't equate in terms of forces involved. You can see the force ratios there on the slides. We're talking millions on both sides. Mosul does not compare to Stalingrad in terms of total casualties. Again, you can see those on the slide, mega casualties and historical significance. However, Mosul and Stalingrad do intersect in terms of intensity of the combat and physical destruction of the city. What's remarkable about this is this intensity of the combat did not take the clash of pure nation-state armies. This intensity of combat resulted from a fairly lightly armed, very determined, but fairly lightly armed terrorist, hybrid terrorist, quasi-conventional force fighting a relatively modern conventional army. So you can see there, I won't drill into all the data there, but essentially Stalingrad took about 5 months of conflict, five or six. Mosul was 9 months. The participants talked about war in the rubble in Stalingrad, among the remains of buildings, chimneys, cellars, gutted warehouses, factories, with no mercy for civilians and few prisoners taken. You could almost take those words and transplant them onto Mosul. Also, high level of strain on the participants. I know that the Iraqi security forces had a lot of strain. I saw some commanders break down under that strain. I saw some units break under the strain of combat, and we saw it in enemy intelligence and among some of the prisoners as well. ISIS fought until the end after 9 months of combat. You can see there, we've changed the slide, you can see the slides entitled Intensity of Urban Warfare. That's a scene from the west side of Mosul in the latter stages of the battle. And if you just kind of contrast that with the scenes you saw in the previous slide of Stalingrad, you can see what I'm talking about in the intersection of intensity and destruction that was wrought. So the west side took the most damage. The Battle of Mosul started on the east side. The city split by a river, a lot like Stalingrad. The early stages of the battle took part on the east side. The east side was spared a lot of destruction because ISIS foothold was less on the east side, partly because of the flow and power of the city that existed. ISIS didn't have good places they could dig into the east side. They weren't as welcome on the east side. There were hostile neighborhoods to ISIS on the east side. So they dug in where they could. So the damage was less there. Their final stronghold was on the west side, where the population was a bit more sympathetic. Also the oldest part of the city was on the west side of the city against the rivers called Old Mosul. And you can imagine centuries of construction on top. There was an underground, a subterranean part there, a warren, very narrow streets. Some streets in the old part of the city wouldn't even support passage of a Humvee. Very dense and tough. Urban construction, thick walls, old stone, etc. The battle took 9 months. The last stages of the battle took over 2 weeks. Literally, the enemy was eventually forced into a small postage stamp of the city, initially about 400 by 400 meters square. It took a week or two to work that down to about a 200 by 200 meters square. It took another week or 10 days to actually clear that final tiny postage stamp of 200 by 200 meters. Imagine collapsed buildings. They produce some of the most impenetrable bunkers you can imagine. So imagine a five-story building being collapsed down on top of the first, what's surviving is the first floor and the basement. And the other four stories now are 20 or 30 feet a cap of reinforced concrete, steel rebar reinforced concrete rubble. When we design munitions, we design munitions to penetrate through constructed buildings, poured concrete, this rubble acts a lot like the rubber pellets that you find on athletic fields nowadays. So this final 200 yards, or 200 meters by 200 meters, was buildings where the bottom floor survived, the bunker survived, and you had a really tough cap of overhead cover on top of that. Really tough problem to solve. The final stages of the fight look like something that you might observe from World War II. The assault forces were led by a bulldozer, and on each side of the bulldozer was a squad of infantry, and their mission was to protect the bulldozer from IED or RPG attack. And the bulldozer was doing the clearing and destruction. It was doing it by identifying where ISIS popped up out of a hole or outside of a building, and the bulldozer would promptly turn and bury them, bury that exit point, and bury the ISIS fighters in it, while the infantry protected the bulldozer. It was a remarkable sight to see, and something I never really expected to see other than watching World War II footage of combat in urban areas. So also something that we observed there advising our Iraqi counterparts is that our maps and our imagery, our command and control systems had a hard time keeping up with the battle. The urban landscape changes so rapidly that our C2 systems, our targeting systems, wherever we had maps and imagery repositories of that, they became outdated very quickly because the urban landscape was changing faster than we could update our imagery that we were looking at the battlefield with. The bottom line is, I think urban combat, especially in a megacity, is going to be extraordinarily violent and extraordinarily destructive for both the security forces on either side of us and our adversaries and the people who remain there. I think our armies, the coalition forces, if we fought the Battle of Mosul, we would have probably done it faster. I think we would have done it with less destruction and probably fewer casualties. But even so, Mosul would have been a very hard problem for us as well. And because the enemies, the enemy has watched Mosul. I know that ISIS has. The heightened threats of the world have. I think probably nation states have also watched it. I think they will deliberately go to the cities and dig in there to fight because they know that it takes away a lot of our technological advantages. Our sensors are degraded in the urban environment. The range of our sensors is degraded. The range of our weapons are degraded. The effects of our weapons, as I've described a little bit, are degraded. So I think we're going to see a battle in megacities, and there's little way to avoid it, I think. So I'll just close here before I take questions by saying that I think your region of the world, the Indo-Pacific region, the Asia-Pacific region, I think you have the environment there where you have all these challenges, all the same challenges I've been describing that I lived in Iraq and Syria. Are there. There are adversaries there that I think are going to confront our partnerships in the region, and I think we need to continue to work on our common understanding of these challenges and our interoperability. I think we're going to need your help, so as we evolve and develop this concept we're calling multi-domain operations, we'll need your help, and as we look at combat in megacities, I know we need your help for that. I think you can count on the United States as a partner, and we're looking forward to try to find a way to improve our interoperability. And in that area, TRADOC, Training and Doctrine Command, stands ready to assist U.S. Army Pacific. All right, I'll stop there. Thanks for your attention, and now I'll take your questions. Over.
Good. Thanks very much, General Townsend, for that insight. And as you know, General Brown and a couple of others of us in the room have some carry some personal baggage for Mosul, and so that that update from you was timely and certainly important. We've got a number of questions. I'll combine a couple of them in the interest of time. So the first deal with prioritization and modernization, and given where you are headed with multi-domain operations, and given the Secretary of the Army and the Chief of Staff of the U.S. Army's modernization priorities and the prioritization for funding and the top six priorities, the question is that some of these seem to leave out many of the combat enabling capabilities that are critical to the unique needs of commanders in the Pacific theater. Does the Army need to invest in other areas to enable successful multi-domain operations in the Pacific outside of the top six? So basically, how do you reconcile the capabilities needed to successfully implement multi-domain operations with the funding and modernization priorities articulated by the senior Army leaders?
Okay, thanks, General Hamm. And yes, I do recognize that you and General Brown and others there have some time invested in the battle I was just talking about. In fact, it was, I think, in Mosul where I first met you. We first began our professional association in Mosul. When I arrived at Fort Lewis in those days, you were already deployed, and I met you downrange. I met Bob Brown at Fort Lewis before he deployed. So, yeah, it's good to at least share with you that story of its liberation. Sad part is the state of the city now after liberation. Now, to get to your question on priorities and modernization, I think from the Army's perspective, our priorities of both modernization and multi-domain operations and potential contingencies in the Asia-Pacific region are very well nested. So as you know, there are six top priorities for the U.S. Army. All of them have multi-domain operations interwoven throughout them. They have operations in megacities interwoven throughout them, and they are theater agnostic. In fact, not only are they theater agnostic, but the European theater and the Pacific theater are actually stated as focus areas for those priorities. And I can give you just a few examples. Long-range precision fires is the purpose of that is to help us, first of all, penetrate the enemy's anti-access area denial bubble. And the multi-domain task force, we deliberately fielded to the Pacific region as a deliberate decision to do that because there are challenges there with potential adversaries using anti-access and area denial capabilities to keep us from having freedom of movement and maneuver throughout the region. So long-range precision fires helps us get at that and helps us maneuver in all domains. So imagine Army land-based fires opening up, breaching holes in the enemy's anti-access bubble so that naval forces and air forces can move through that breach and operate inside that anti-access bubble. Next generation combat vehicle is being specifically designed to operate in cities, and it's the requirements for that require it to be smaller, more maneuverable in the urban environment. It's got to have heavier, more protection on the top, and it's got to have a gun that can traverse in 360 and elevate much higher than the armored vehicles that we have today. Those are just a couple of examples of how these priorities are nested for both the Asia-Pacific region and multi-domain operations in megacities. Soldier lethality is another one, where we're really focused on enhancing the lethality and survivability of the individual soldier and small unit, the squad and platoon, so they can operate in megacities. I would say the one area we probably need to look at is sustainment. There's not a cross-functional team for sustainment. Sustainment is interwoven into all of these priorities, but it's apparent to me that as we're looking at some of these budget drills that I've been in, that sustainment is a war-fighting function that definitely needs some focus. So that's something I'll turn my attention to here in the coming months, is that area. But I think the rest of our priorities in modernization are really well nested, and they are on track to support operations in the Asia-Pacific region. Over.
Good. Thanks very much, General Townsend. The next questions deal with mission command, and two kind of related questions, I believe. How does operations in megacities affect mission command doctrine, and what adjustments may need to be made to, for executing mission command in that megacity environment? And specifically, how do we get the right authorities pushed down to the tactical commanders in this environment, especially at the division, BCT, and below levels?
Thanks, General Hamm. Okay, so mission command. This is the greatest topic near and dear to my heart. I know it is to General Brown's as well. So I think megacities is a great little microscope to look at mission command in. So first of all, our doctrine. I think mission command is almost purpose-made for fighting in megacities. The whole idea of using mission orders to convey commander's intent and allow empower disciplined initiative at the tactical edge, that's how battle is going to play out in megacities. We watch this play out every day in Mosul. As powerful as our mission command systems are, they are all challenged by the environment, the complex terrain that is a city, a modern city. And you can't go more than about one room deep into a building without losing comms with whoever's outside that building. You can't go more than one floor deep underground without losing comms with everybody who's up on the surface. You can't go more than two or three floors up without losing comms again. So this whole notion of conveying commander's intent and empowering subordinates to implement, to use their disciplined initiative to achieve that commander's intent and trust them to do that is exactly how we will have to fight in even small cities. So I think it's exactly the right doctrine. Our capabilities need some work. And I was recently visiting one of our agencies that looks at technology for this area. In fact, they're examining technology for combat in urban environments and subterranean environments. And they're coming up with some pretty unique little systems there that will empower us to do mission command in this environment. For example, something as simple as a little puck that you drop as you advance down a subterranean corridor. You drop these pucks at the intersections, and they transmit your position locating information as well as your comms, little relay pucks that you just drop behind you, sort of like crumbs as you advance into the urban terrain. So those things are being worked on right now. On your question of authorities, this is a good one. And I've got a backup slide here. Do they have the backup slides, Tino? Okay, can we bring up the multi-domain operations episodic synchronization slide? This slide right here. So I'm talking off a slide now. I don't know if you have it up. It's called episodic multi-domain operations today, episodic synchronization. Okay, let me talk about authorities here for a second. So this is a vignette that actually played out during and after the Battle of Mosul and after the Battle of Raqqa. This played out during my time in Iraq and Syria at Combined Joint Task Force Operation Inherent Resolve. And so you can see there's the Euphrates River Valley, and you can see the Iraq-Syria border. You can see Raqqa up there. Started advancing down into this area there in the center of the slide we referred to as the middle Euphrates River Valley between Al-Qaim in Iraq and Raqqa in Syria. And the little solid enemy symbols there were enemy command posts. And also they were propaganda site nodes. So these were their primary command posts. And we knew that the enemy had alternate command posts, but we didn't know where they were. And those are indicated by the little dashed symbols and the question marks. We knew they were there. We weren't sure where they were. And so rather than strike the primary command post and then have the enemy be unknown to us for a while we reacquired where he went to, the thought was one of our subordinate units proposed that we use multi-domain operations capabilities from space and cyber to deny the enemy's primary command post, thus forcing him to move to and unveil his alternate command post, which we did. And we struck the alternate command post kinetically with kinetic fires, lethal fires, once we identified them, and we worked our way backwards to the primary command post. So this operation worked pretty well. It's a multi-domain operation unfolded in air, land, and sea, cyberspace, and space. However, it took us 2 or 3 weeks to put this operation together that folded over a period of about 1 week. And a lot of that was organizing, pulling together and organizing all these domains and seeking the authorities that we had that don't reside at the JTF or Corps or Division or Brigade levels. So some of these authorities are held at national levels, and some of our different international partners that are part of the combined and joint task force had authorities also of their own and capabilities also of their own at different levels. So the bottom line is it took us a couple of weeks to organize this multi-domain, pretty sophisticated but small, multi-domain operation that lasted less than a week, and it was against an enemy who could not really contest us in any of the domains. Now let's look to future war against a near-peer threat that can contest us in one or more or all of the domains. We're going to have to do better than what I call today episodic synchronization. We're going to have to do continuous integration, and that's what this slide depicts here. We've actually got to be able, when the adversaries, combined arms armies, come rolling, we're going towards our alliance. We're going to have to generate sophisticated multi-domain operations in minutes and hours, and those operations will have to last days and weeks. So we have to flip this paradigm, turn this timeline around from what I experienced in Syria, and part of that is capabilities, part of that is training, but part of it is authorities. Over.
Thanks very much. We've got just a minute or two left. Just if you could comment very quickly on what changes do you foresee at the combat training centers and for home station training to prepare units for operation for multi-domain operations in megacities, with a particular question about subterranean operations.
Okay, thanks, Joham. So the changes. So what we're seeing play out, not just at our combat training centers, certainly there, but also in our simulations and also at home station training, is we are working on the synthetic training environment, which will allow us to do a better job at challenging in simulations our formations and soldiers and leaders. So our simulations have not kept up with changes in our formations and the changes in warfare and the changes in capabilities. So we've got to advance our simulations. So we're working on that. And we want to get away from how we train. We have to go to the sim center now, and you have to do days or weeks of training, coordination and planning to do a small simulation exercise at the simulation center. What we want to do is we want to be able to do battles every day, even in your unit's footprint. Anywhere on your home station, anywhere you are, you can run simulated battles right there. And you've heard Secretary Mattis has used this frame that he wants every soldier and Marine to have fought 25 simulated battles before they fight their first real battle. So we've got to get out of this mind that the simulation is a standalone center. Simulation training is done in a standalone brick-and-mortar building that you have to schedule, do weeks of planning and coordination to use for a few hours. We've got to do simulations everywhere, all time where we are. So we're working on that. That is a one of our priority elements is actually sort of a quasi-CFT, is a simulated training environment. At the combat training centers, we are integrating space and cyber capabilities. We've got closed-loop systems now on those training centers where we can play cyber pretty much full up and not have to worry about our training war leaking out into the real cyberspace. We can contain, but let them play, get attacked, and defend themselves and counterattack aggressively in cyberspace at our training centers without worry that it'll spill out of the training center. Now, then you mentioned urban and subterranean. So I was just at the asymmetric warfare group recently, and they have built a model subterranean training center that we're now the Army's in the process of exporting to home stations, the combat training centers and home stations. So it's a modular thing, and it was an epiphany to me that if you are inside this subterranean training facility, you don't know that it's not actually buried underground. I was thinking to myself before I went and saw it, how are we going to be able to afford to build all these underground training facilities? Well, they took me into one that wasn't underground at all. It actually looked like you went underground at the entrance, but the facility was actually built above the ground, but you couldn't tell that once you went inside of it. And so it all seemed very much underground. So we've got this model, a template for this training facility. It's reasonably priced. We're exporting them and putting them, moving them around the Army as quickly as we can. And the Army's looking at increasing the size and scale of our urban warfare facilities. They're too sterile. They're too clean. One rule I would impose right now, Army-wide, is I'd say you don't have to clean it up after you train in there. Usually we make the unit go through and do a very detailed police call, scrub it down, pick up all the brass and smoke grenade bodies and police up all your concertina wire. Haven't seen those pictures of Mosul. I just leave all that debris and junk and trash in place because that's how an urban battlefield actually looks. We cannot expand all of our little urban warfare training centers to the degree necessary. We're going to have to do that in simulations. We're going to have to portray megacities in simulations because there's no way we're going to build megacities. We might build larger urban combat facilities, but they'll fall far short of what we might call a large urban area or a megacity. So we're going to have to do those in simulations, and we got to expose our leaders. One of the things we were doing in New York was doing discussions up there with those leaders so we could bring leaders up there for staff rides, for toots, tactical exercises without troops, to expose them to the scope and scale of a large urban battlefield without actually having to bring troops up there and train in that environment. Over.
Well, thanks, General Townsend, and regrettably, that's all the time we have. Thanks for your insights and your observations. Thanks for your generosity and time. We wish that you were here, but understand why you can't be in continuing the important work of training and doctrine and command. Ladies and gentlemen, how about a round of applause for General Townsend? Thank you.
Thanks, General Hamm, and to General Brown there. I really appreciate this opportunity. I'm really glad that I was able to do this. Again, my apologies for not being there in person. But I'm really happy that I was able to do this, and y'all have a great rest of your conference. That's it from Virginia.
Good. Okay. Aloha. Thank you very much, General Townsend. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're ready for our